Harper Audio presents Rebbe, the life and teachings of Menachem M. Schneerson, the most influential rabbi in modern history, by Joseph Telushkin, performed by Richard Topol. Preface. I entered into the writing of this book with a high regard for the Rebbe. Why else devote years of one's life to focusing on another person's life and teachings? And after 5 years of research and writing, I came out with an even higher one. Much, I know, has been said of the Rebbe, both true and untrue, both highly adulatory and highly critical, and thus I pursued my subject with much scrutiny and with open eyes. Along the way, I learned that one can have great admiration for a person with whom one has profound disagreements. To cite just two, unlike the Rebbe, I believe that it is very worthwhile for Israel, under certain conditions, to make territorial compromises with the Palestinians, just as I believe it was right for her to do so with Egypt, a position the Rebbe believed would put lives at risk, and that I believe saved lives. Also, I was an ardent member of the student struggle for Soviet Jewry, and supporter of anti-Soviet demonstrations during the 1960s and 1970s, a time of severe anti-Semitism by the Soviet government, at a time when the Rebbe was convinced that such demonstrations were harming Russian Jews and that only quiet diplomacy could improve their situation. In the course of researching this book, I learned things I hadn't known, that the Rebbe, despite his fervent opposition to demonstrations, was a more nuanced and practical thinker on the issue of how to help Russian Jews than many people, I being one of them, realized. True, he opposed anti-Soviet demonstrations, but on the quiet, out of earshot of the Russians, and in addition to the secret work he was spearheading to maintain Jewish life inside Russia, he found ways to cooperate with people who supported them. And I believe that the actions taken by both sides greatly helped the Jews of Russia. In general, I was struck again and again by the nuanced nature of the Rebbe's thinking. Thus, to no one's surprise, the Rebbe thought that Reform and Conservative Judaism were wrong-headed in their approach to Judaism, but when a Reform rabbi asked him if he should leave his congregation, the Rebbe told him, "You're a soldier on the front," the sort of response he might well have given one of his shluchim, emissaries, and told the man that not only should he not leave his congregation, but that he should challenge his congregants to do more, and even challenge him, the Rebbe, to do more as well. Perhaps the most unanticipated result of the researching and writing of this book is the profound impact it has had on my life. Given that the Rebbe transformed so many people's lives, it is perhaps not surprising that he has impacted the life of this biographer as well, in many ways. Most significantly, the Rebbe's innate optimism and his focus on the use of optimistic language has changed me, I hope, forever. I was first struck when I learned of the Rebbe's refusal to use the word Beit Cholim, the Hebrew term for hospital, a word that literally means house of the sick, and which the Rebbe felt demoralized people. I immediately realized he was right. Similarly, because of the Rebbe, I have stopped using the word deadline, substituting instead due date, the first term, which is so widely used, connoting the end of life, and the second, life's beginning. Does this change seem minor and petty? Maybe minor, but certainly not petty. There are few things we use more often than words, and the types of verbal changes the Rebbe recommended, which invariably involved seeking out encouraging words, have in turn changed me. My wife, Devorah, often commented that whenever I spent the day researching at 770 Eastern Parkway, the generic address for the Chabad movement's Brooklyn headquarters, I came home in an uplifted, invigorated mood. That is because Lubavitchers as a group are upbeat, a result in large part of the influence exerted upon them by the Rebbe and his teachings, even now, almost 20 years since his death. If one can make a generalization about so large a group of people as Lubavitcher Hasidim, one generalization I feel comfortable in making is that Lubavitchers exude a warm calm and optimism. They avoid negative language, and the mood they convey is contagious. I am a happier and more spiritual person as a result of writing this book, and I would like to believe more generous and less judgmental of others. All of these things would not have occurred if not for the fact that my life was consumed in learning the details of the life and thinking of the seventh Rebbe of Chabad. Similarly, the Rebbe's insistence that anything worth doing should be done now and not delayed, even in instances in which most of us would delay, has repeatedly caused me to act in a more forthright and direct manner. If a difficult phone call has to be made or a difficult issue confronted, I am now more likely than in the past to not procrastinate, but to do so right away. I'm not yet sure if I have the guts to also do so even in the middle of the night, as the Rebbe sometimes advocated. The Rebbe's impact on my life has grown strong, and I suspect will grow stronger in a whole host of spiritual, ethical, and ritual ways over the coming years. It is difficult to be exposed to the teachings of such a man and not be affected in some fundamental ways. I hope and expect that these impacts will long endure. I was well aware of the Rebbe as a significant figure before researching and writing this book, but have come to appreciate over these past years the magnitude of his achievements. Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson assumed leadership of a relatively small movement of Lubavitcher Hasidim in 1951, and he turned Chabad into the most dynamic and geographically diverse religious movement in Jewish life. Furthermore, his influence extended well beyond his movement. The outgoing chief rabbi of Great Britain, Lord Jonathan Sacks, described well the enormity of the Rebbe's accomplishments. Among the very greatest Jewish leaders of the past, there were some who transformed communities. There were others who raised up many disciples. There were yet others who left us codes and commentaries which will be studied for all time. But there have been few in the entire history of one of the oldest peoples in the world who in one lifetime made their influence felt throughout the entire Jewish world. The Rebbe was one of the immortals. Early on in my work on this book, I met Ben Fetterman, a highly successful young businessman with a fascinating background. His father was a man of great kindness, a computer whiz who loved nature and whose family is involved in the movie and entertainment industry. His mother, a social worker, hails from an old Lubavitch family, while her father was an early Maccabiah champion weightlifter. Ben himself is an Army veteran, a U.S. history buff, and an innovative entrepreneur. We bonded at a dinner over our mutual interest in Civil War history, as well as our curiosity to discover more about the Rebbe's personality and a desire to reach a greater understanding of who he was. Ben subsequently granted me the great gift of time by making it possible for me to devote the years necessary to bring this book to fruition. I am grateful, as well as honored, to dedicate this volume to Ben Fetterman's parents. One of the great joys of working on this book was knowing the immense gratification of both my father, Shlomo Telushkin, of blessed memory, and my grandfather, Rabbi Nissen Telushkin, of blessed memory, would have in knowing that their son and grandson was writing a book about a man whom they so esteemed. My grandfather was long ensconced in the world of Chabad, had a close relationship with both the Rebbe and his father-in-law, the Friedike, previous Rebbe, and is indeed buried only a few feet away from the Ohel, where the two Rebbes are interred. My father served as the accountant to the Rebbe and to his father-in-law as well. He held this position from shortly after the arrival of the Friedike Rebbe in the United States and was very proud of this connection. When people had a private meeting with the Rebbe, it was known as a yechidus. My father had an annual yechidus with the Rebbe on or just before April 15th, when the Rebbe would sign his tax return, and my father, in turn, would have the chance to speak to and consult with the Rebbe about various personal, professional, and familial matters going on in his life. I myself didn't get married until deep into my 30s, and I remember the happiness my father had when he brought home one day from 770 a bottle of vodka given to him by the Rebbe, which he told my father was to be opened at a simcha, a joyous occasion, for me. A couple of years later, when a book I had written was about to be published, I jokingly asked my father if we could open the bottle at a launch party for the book. My father said, "This is not the simcha the Rebbe meant." Indeed, the bottle was opened at my wedding. When my father was in his mid-70s and started to give up some of his clients, he always made it clear that he would work as Chabad's accountant as long as he had the strength, that this would be the last client he would ever give up. As positive as my associations with Lubavitch were, while growing up and for many years after, I was not at all closely involved in these parts of my father's and grandfather's lives. Lubavitch, for much of my life, was something always dear to me, but often from a distance, and not actively on my radar. In some ways, therefore, these past years of researching and writing have not only acquainted me with the Rebbe in a way I had not previously known, but brought me to a deeper and more intimate knowledge of both my father and grandfather, of the spiritual paths they trod, and of the very special role Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson played in their lives. In the course of researching and writing this book, I've come to understand them better, to grow closer to them, even though my grandfather died in 1970 and my father in 1987, and I regard this as a sacred gift. Sometimes, as I commuted to the Chabad offices in Crown Heights to do my research, it felt as if I were visiting my father as well. So many Chabadniks shared with me recollections of seeing my father working there. The sense of satisfaction increased when my daughter Shira spent 3 months in the early stages of this project helping me research and define the areas of the Rebbe's life that I wished to explore. And as my son, Benjamin, Ben Zion, interned in the summer at Chabad.org, the Chabad website that attracted 37 million visitors last year. As a believer in an afterlife, I sense my father and grandfather are aware their son and grandson has been chronicling the life and teachings of the Rebbe, and that this has been a source of great satisfaction to them. This thought, which obviously I can't prove, but which I strongly believe, is very precious to me. More precious than rubies, as the Bible would say. Part 1. Leadership of the Rebbe. Chapter 1. A Rebbe for the New World. In 1994, a few months after his passing, Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, the Lubavitch Rebbe, was posthumously awarded the Congressional Gold Medal, the highest award granted by the American government to a civilian. He's the only rabbi and only the second clergyman to have received this honor. The rarely awarded gold medal is designated for those who have performed an achievement that has an impact on American history and culture that is likely to be recognized long after the achievement. At the award ceremony, African-American Congressman John Lewis, the civil rights legend and co-sponsor of the award, noted that perhaps the only issue on which he and Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich agreed was the importance of bestowing this medal on the Lubavitcher Rebbe. Congressman Lewis, citing his awe at the Rebbe's accomplishments, expressed his sorrow that neither he nor his mentor, the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., had ever met the Rebbe. Gingrich, yet another co-sponsor, spoke not just of the Rebbe's integrity, but of his respect for the Rebbe's representatives whom he had met in Washington. Gingrich described his good feeling at being approached by one of the Rebbe's emissaries, someone not in the right Gucci shoes and not in the right Italian suit, who doesn't ask you to increase their profit margin, but instead says, "For the good of the world, this is something noble and idealistic that should be done." And that's why, Gingrich concluded, he felt so celebratory that day. Nor was it only Lewis and Gingrich who felt this admiration for the Rebbe. President Ronald Reagan, upon receiving letters from the Rebbe, would take them upstairs from the Oval Office to his residence and personally draft his responses. In an April 1982 letter, the president cited words from a proclamation for a National Day of Reflection he was about to issue, honoring the Rebbe's 80th birthday. "Your work stands as a reminder to us all that knowledge is an unworthy goal unless it is accompanied by moral and spiritual wisdom and understanding." When a national scroll of honor signed by President Reagan was awarded to the Rebbe, every single member of the House of Representatives and Senate signed it as well. By 1990, when Peggy Noonan, the longtime White House speechwriter, published What I Saw at the Revolution, her best-selling political memoir, the Rebbe had become a widely acknowledged cultural reference. When speculating in the book's final pages about moral issues that Noonan, of Irish Catholic descent, felt were better addressed by religious rather than political leaders, she specified three: the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, and the Pope. By the Rebbe's later years, and continuing after his death, his impact had become far-reaching in a manner dissimilar from any other modern rabbinic figure. In 2013, on the night preceding his election to the Senate, Democratic candidate Cory Booker, an African-American Christian, went to the Ohel, the site of the Rebbe's grave, to pray. It was done in a private manner, no journalists were present, and the visit only came to public attention after the election.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.